Good morning. Good to see everybody. Why don't we stand as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning? God, we thank you that your love never fails, God, that it's never ending. I ask that we would experience your love in a new way this morning, God, as your children, as your sons and your daughters. Let's just sing the chorus.
Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love,
higher than the mountains,
for me. Love's like a hurricane, I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of this wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Thank you.
us so much. We receive the love that you're pouring out this morning. Thank you for your sweet presence, God.
You. Hallelujah. Yeah. What a good God we serve. Amen. Yeah, he's worthy. Come on, you can clap. If you're at home, you can praise him. You can speak a praise, a blessing. Tell the Lord just how good he is. Amen. He's worthy to be exalted. You know, some of you need to do that today. You need to posture yourself in a place where you exalt God above. Come on now. You got to exalt him above your problems. You got to exalt him over the issues within the country. You got to exalt him over your finances. You got to exalt him over the relationship struggles that you might have. Come on now. It's time to exalt our God. You got to lift him up. God, we exalt you. Yeah. We praise you, God. We lift you up. We declare your praises. We know you're bigger. We know you're stronger. We know you're greater than coronavirus. We know you're greater than the upcoming election. We know you're greater than any health issue that is in this body or in our church or those online. God is greater. So we exalt you, God. We know you're greater than the struggle that we might face. We know you're greater than the hopelessness we might feel, God. You're greater. So today we take our eyes off our circumstances and we take our eyes off of ourselves and we fix our eyes on Jesus, who is the author, the perfecter of our faith, the one who overcame the grave. Come on. We serve a resurrected God. We serve the Almighty God. We serve the God who's above and then even higher and higher. Oh, give him praise today. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. It's a time for the church to be the church and exalt our God. Come on. We exalt you today, God. We lift you up. We sing your praises. You're so worthy. You're worthy of our honor. You're worthy of our praise, God. Woo! Live it, love him. Yes, yes, yes. So we bless your name, God. I pray, Father, for your spirit now to carry this praise, that it won't just be a moment, but it'll be a lifestyle, God, that we'll live this way. We'll walk above our situations. We'll walk with our heads up, knowing who our God is. We'll walk in that spirit and in that power, knowing what you've done, knowing that Jesus even overcame sin and death. Hallelujah. Thank you for living within us. Thank you for choosing us. Thank you for accepting us. Wow, we're humbled, God. And we'll be careful. We'll be careful, Holy Spirit, to walk tenderly with you. In Jesus' name. If you're in agreement, say amen. Amen. Give the Lord a clap as you find your seats today. Yeah, he's good. Wow, he's good. He's so good. Well, welcome to church. Amen. And welcome all those who are online watching. It's great to have you joining us here from wherever you are around the world. We bless you. Welcome to The Crossing this morning. My name is Pierre, one of the pastors here on staff. I want to just welcome you into worship today. It's a great way to start your week, to worship our God. Amen. I want you to do me a favor right now. Pull out your cell phone. Pull out your cell phone. Yes, I'm telling you to pull out your cell phone in church. And then I want you to open up your contacts. Do that right now. Open up a contact, create a new contact, and call that contact what you want, but it's a Crossing text messaging contact. So create a new contact, and once you get that contact created, I'm going to give you the number. I'm going to give it to you several times. It's 215-999-4993. One more time. 215-999-4993. All right, one more time. 215-999-4993. Now, here's the deal. That number can communicate with us back and forth so we can talk to you, text you, tell you about upcoming events. You can register for things all without touching a piece of paper, all without going anywhere, right from the comforts of your own home or wherever you find yourself at work. You text that number of prayer. We'll pray for you. We're going to have different hashtags and codes and things that you can communicate with us. In fact, the first one today, maybe you've been checking The Crossing out and you're wondering how you take that next step of becoming part of this family. We would love to have you join our upcoming membership class. It's going to start in November. And all we need to do is take that same number and text the word begin to that number. And we'll get you information about the upcoming membership course. So text the word begin. It's not case sensitive, lowercase, uppercase, B, G, E, G, I, N, doesn't matter. Text the word begin to 215-999-4993, and we'll be in touch with you about the upcoming course. And that course is a way in which you can understand the Crossing's history, you can understand our values, you can understand our purpose, you can understand what we believe in, and you can have the opportunity to become one of us and change the world together with us. It's the first step before you join our other ministry teams like prayer team and the healing team and Mashah team and all these other great teams, is to join us to learn about our vision and to connect with other people who are also new. One last announcement is tonight, we're gonna have a call to prayer at 6 o'clock right here in the worship center, but also online. So wherever you feel most comfortable and able, you can join us in the worship center. You can join us on Facebook or on YouTube. Don't you think we need some prayer right now? Amen? So we're going to come together. We're going to pray in one heart, one mind, one spirit, exalting our God, knowing that he's worthy. All right, Pastor Scott has an awesome word for you. God bless you.
All right, I tell you, it's so good to be here today, seeing you here in the building and also those online watching. So glad that you're with us today. I want to thank you, really, for your faithfulness, for the way in which you've been giving to the Crossing. I can't tell you how much that's just really helped us. You can imagine. I've talked with people who have heard stories of churches who are just struggling, and your faithfulness has really helped us to continue this ministry during the pandemic. And I just want to just pray blessings on you. Thank you for your faithfulness. And by the way, I hope you've seen this building going up over here. Have you seen it? I mean, it really is something. It is a miracle. It honestly is. And again, thank you for giving to that as well. But wow, it's exciting, and you can see it is becoming a reality. It's just fantastic. You know, today we begin a new series, and I really was praying about what is the next thing that we're to do, especially during this time of a pandemic, and how we live into this moment, how we live into this time. How do we do that? How do we live into this moment of our lives? And I think that's really something that we want to look at, how we can live into this challenging moment. I think that there are so many pressures upon our lives, so many, from so many different directions, that it's important to really hear what it means to live for God in this season. And that's why I want to ask you this question today. In this season, who is God calling you to be? Now, that question is a question I've asked you before, and it has to do with vision. You know, when you're living in a time of turmoil and difficulty, it is all too easy to lose sight of who God has called you to be. There are a lot of pressures upon life, upon your life. Maybe you're facing it. You're going through the things that are just overwhelming to you. It's important to get a picture of what God really wants for your life. And that's how God wants us to think, about thinking through his eyes. It's only when we begin to see our life through the eyes of God that we really begin to see who our lives are called to be. The problem is that we get off track. When you go through times of turmoil and stress, when the world is changing so quickly, you can get so caught up in that. Maybe there are things that are happening in your life personally as well. The world around you is changing, the things you're facing are challenging, and you feel stretched beyond belief. And when you're in one of those moments, it's easy to take on the world's view rather than God's view of your life. That's why it's important that we have to learn to own God's picture of our lives and not just our own. We have to say, God, I want to become who you have called me to become, not what the world says I'm to become. See, right now, I'm telling you, there's a battle. And there's a battle that's happening in your life. And it's a battle over your future. It's a battle over the vision you have for your life. And it will come down to basic decisions that are subtle along the way. Questions you have to ask about your life. And they'll all relate to this issue of vision. Ultimately, every day, you'll get to decide what will define your life. What will define your choices? You'll get to make those decisions. You get to answer the question, how am I going to react to everything that's happening? How am I to respond in a time like this? They're vision questions. How decisions I make, how I react, they're vision questions. See, there's a battle taking place today. And it's a battle over your future. It's a battle for the vision of your life. And that's why today, I want to give you God's picture for your life. Found in just three simple words. But these words are so important because I think they really encapsulate what it is, who it is, that God's really calling us to become. I love searching the scripture and finding stories of people who are in situations like us. People who are battling for their future. People who are battling for the vision of their life and sort of figuring out how they did it. What did God say in their moment? And today we're going to look at a text that deals exactly with that. In fact, in the weeks ahead, we're going to anchor ourselves in this book all with the idea that God will release those words so fresh in our life that we will step right into that identity, right into that future, right into that living word and embrace it for our lives. I think that's the hope God has as we share his word. I'm calling this series, and we'll be teaching as a staff, Above It All. Above it all, because you know why? Because Jesus Christ is above it all. And because you know him, your life is above it all. And that's why we're going to look at the book of Colossians. We're going to take some lessons out of this book. And today I want to begin with what appears to be the simplest of passages. Many of us, when we read these words, so if we're reading the Bible and reading Paul's letters, sort of blow right past them because they just sort of seem introductory and they're just sort of nothing. And the real content is much later on. But if that's your perspective, you're missing out on some real gold in the very beginning of this letter. We're going to really spend the day just sort of parked in a verse. We're going to allow God to really speak to us about our lives and the vision he has for our lives. So I want to read this to you. I'll begin in verse 1. We're going to sort of focus really on verse 2. But it says in Colossians 1, he says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, grace and peace to you from God our Father. Now we have in this book something interesting. The first picture of what God has for our life is found in verse 2. Paul uses the word holy. That's the picture. God's picture of your life. What his perfect will is for you is to be a holy people. It's a really interesting phrase that Paul begins with. As I said, I've learned to pay attention to the opening of Paul's letters. Sometimes we just dismiss them. But if you do here, you miss out on the whole purpose of his writing. You see, in verse 2, he gives the thesis for his book. He's going to be spending 4 chapters breaking down what it means to be a holy people. And this is just laying out his thesis. It's where he's going. And this word, it's important. As he writes to the people of Colossae, what makes it so? What is the issue with them? I mean, what is driving Paul to address this? Well, you know, Paul's never been to Colossae. It may surprise you, he's never been there. But he knows of them through someone we're going to see a little bit later in this message. But he hears about their struggles, and their struggle is that somehow the pressure of the culture is defining them. It's defining what they believe and how the choices they're making in their life. Like if you were to go in deeper into this book, you'd see the things they believed. They sort of believed in blending all these kind of religions together, like sort of a little bit of Christianity and a little bit of Judaism and a little bit of magic and folk religion and blending it all together and somehow thinking that this is what it means to be someone who can live today in a challenging world. You blend together all these spiritualities. And maybe they were afraid. They were afraid of the world in which they were living, afraid of the spiritual forces that were all around them. And maybe today you're afraid. Afraid of the spiritual forces, afraid of things that are happening, and you feel that fear as well. Paul's speaking to them. He's speaking into their life about who they are in God, and he uses this word holy. You understand how they got there. I mean, our tendency is to read these books as if they're static. Like, you know, Paul knows them and they're the same people he's known before. But that's just not true. As we said, he didn't even know them really. He's never met them. Unless they came to Ephesus there and preach. But, you know, it's this issue that, you know, maybe there are those who've been believers for a while. Paul writes the book of Colossians like 62 AD. He was in Ephesus in 55. Maybe they were in the revival and they came and heard the revival in Ephesus and went, Ben, who knows? Maybe there were some believers who sort of just never quite really embraced their faith. We've all met believers like that. They pray the prayer, but there's no real change. They pray the prayer, but there's no fruitful evidence in their life that their life really belongs to Jesus. There's something sort of missing. There's something lacking. Maybe that's the case here. Maybe they just need a little bit more definition to help them understand the nature of what they've done and the prayer they prayed. But maybe, and I think more likely, is that many have come into the church. Many new people from all these different backgrounds and here Paul is building this new faith. You don't understand it. You read these letters. We don't appreciate the context of it. This is something radically new. In the Roman Empire, you could only have certain legal religions. Christianity started out as a renewal movement in Judaism. And that's how it was thought of for a long time until they began attracting Gentiles who were not following the law. And then it gets to be a little bit murky. And one thing begins to happen. They begin to step out from the culture. They begin to step away from its morality. And they begin to step into a new morality, a morality of holiness. They step away from the pagan festivals and all the kind of sexual licentiousness of the period. And they were ostracized for it. They were ostracized for that kind of lifestyle. The pressure was great. And in the middle of all this pressure, they feel it. You see, having a sense of vision determines your choices. Knowing who God has called you to be in a world that puts pressure upon you to become someone else. Knowing what it's like to be God's people in a dark world. Will take courage and strength, the things that Paul prays for in this book. So he builds this. It's actually genius. I've never appreciated as much Paul as I have in recent months, as I've just immersed myself in his writings. I just have never seen him like this. I just cannot believe all he's done. He lay this out. He says, you're holy. You understand what it means? You're holy. That's the claim God's made upon your lives. And this is not just some kind of legalism. No, no, no. This word, holy, is the word hagios. You know, it's in the Greek. It means to be separated. It means to be consecrated. It means to be devoted. That's what it means. See, when I begin to think of my life as holy, then I know where my life comes from. I'm separated to God. My life belongs to God. When I say that my life is holy, I know where my life comes from. And I know where my life is headed. And Lord, what I want is my life to show that I know you. See, I have to know not only what my life is committed to, but who my life is committed to. That's what we see here in this passage. To be holy is to talk about the deepest kind of connection. My life, my identity, who defines my life is the very presence of Jesus Christ. Knowing him, experiencing him, drawing close to him in deep connection. I am made for fellowship with God. I am made to be used by God. I am made to be used for God's purposes. And that becomes the most fundamental element of our life, because my life takes on the character of my associations. When I think of all the things we could involve our lives with that can influence us, we want to think of God's presence as the most important influence upon our lives. And Paul begins to write to them. I know you're living in this world and the pressures are upon you, but you're God's people. That's who you are. You don't belong to this world. You belong to heaven. And in Colossians, they're just struggling with that. They're just struggling with it. Maybe they've just lost perspective, or maybe they never claimed it. Maybe they never owned it as their own. That's what Paul's telling him as he begins this letter to God's holy people. We're not there yet. The whole book's about being holy. He wants them to claim it. That's who you're called to be. Either you're God's and God defines your life, or you belong to the world. You can't have both. You can't sit on the fence. Either you belong completely to God or you belong to the world. Either your life is his or it's not. That's the decision Paul just puts before them. There's no middle ground. So each person has to decide the intention of their life, whether or not I'll step into that calling. Paul's encouraging them to see their life from God's perspective, and he begins to paint the picture. I love how he does it. I mean, they're a church that fears the spiritual forces. They fear the darkness. They certainly had practiced magic, and maybe they were still doing it on the side. You know, we see that in Ephesus. It's certainly the case in Acts 19. Hey, you see, look at this. You're thinking, what's going on here in their lives? And Paul begins to declare what God has done. In Colossians 1:13, he says, for he has rescued you from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his Son. When you're holy, you realize there are things that Jesus has called you away from. Your life can't be associated there. That's not what God's called me to. It's what God's called me from. Begin to talk about this whole idea of you've been called out of the dominion of darkness. He says this in Galatians, it's called this present evil age. You are not made to be like the world. You are made to be God's redeemed people in a broken world. Your life is meant to show how God can greatly forgive, how God can greatly restore, how God can greatly bless. You are placed on earth to be heaven's display of God's goodness. It's like, man, you begin to get the picture. You begin to see it. Called you from a dominion of darkness. He'll write later that Christ has just nullified those powers. Nullified the powers of darkness. Canceled them out. Their assignments canceled because his power is greater. Yeah. And he said, you've been called to the kingdom of his son. You've been brought into this kingdom where God reigns. It's like you've changed your standing. You no longer stand in the place of the world. You've now been repositioned. Instead of like, you know, moving to a different location, you move from one state to another, you know. We get into the winter time here, we all think about moving to Florida. You know, where are we going to change our location? We want to change, and Jesus Christ has changed our location. We stand in a different place. And that's exactly what he's saying. You're holy. To be holy means you've changed your location. You don't live in this world. This world, it really isn't your home. You stand in a different place. He writes to the Philippians, a little thing. Paul plays these word games all the time in his letters, and he uses this word only in the Philippian letter because he takes the word polis, the Greek word polis, and he extends it, the word citizen, and he tells them they are citizens of heaven. And that word was a big word in Philippi. It was a big word. They weren't just Roman citizens. They were heaven citizens. And you are heaven citizens. You will never lose sight of who you are. See, only heaven, only the power of heaven can change the earth. I find my life and I allow God's agenda to define me and not the world. Only the light of God can transform this present reality. The battle for your life is over who you will be. Over what will own you. Whether you allow the world to place its mark on you or whether you allow the presence of heaven to place its mark on your life. And all through this book, Paul lays that out. And he shared his journey. He knows what it's like. He feels it. He's been stretched. He's faced opposition. It's not been easy. He made some bold statements in his life. Maybe you have too. One of his most boldest statements is found in his very first letter. I love learning Paul's chronology. It's very helpful in thinking about where we are in his life and what's happening. We don't know exactly his age. Maybe he was born in 5 AD, probably came to faith at 34 AD. He writes his first letter. You know what it was? Galatians. In 49 AD, 15 years into his walk, and he makes this statement as he's trying to address the problems in Galatia. And he says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. In the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. My life, everything is his. Maybe you prayed that prayer. Maybe you believed it at one time in your life, and then you found out. I mean, you talk about the powers of darkness coming against you. It did. And the same thing happened to him. And when you read his story, it's one battle after the other, one struggle after another. But in every moment, God making him stronger, he never lost sight of the fact that he belonged to God. Here's why I want to add this point on. Holy is, you just want to say, keep saying, Lord, my life is yours. Completely, completely yours. And I want to draw close to you and experience you more and more. I want to know you more and more. You want that to be your driving vision. Paul used a second word. He says in Galatians, in Colossians 1:2, he says, not only are you God's holy people, but he calls them faithful. He calls them faithful brothers and sisters. This word faithful is interesting. It's fascinating. It has three meanings. And it's used in Pauline context in different ways. And so there are three ways to understand this word, and it can be translated differently depending upon the context. So the first way it can be used is can be to exercise faith. You're called to exercise faith. We pray for healing, we exercise faith. When we're going through a hardship, we exercise faith, we trust in God. So that one Greek word is pistis. It means to exercise faith and can be translated just that way. But there are times that word can be translated with has to do with content of what you believe. So it doesn't mean necessarily the exercise of faith. It has to do with what you're believing in, what you're trusting in. So when you say, God is faithful, that's a faith statement. It's a declaration. It has content to it. I believe in that. Or when you say, God, I believe God's love is there for me. I believe in God's love. That's a content statement. It fills in the content of what you believe. So the idea is you can have that word, that same Greek word, that means, refers to content. Or when you say that God is good, that's a statement. Content. But the third meaning is interesting. It means to be loyal. It means to have allegiance. And here's Paul's playing a game with us. You miss it, but they don't. Caesar demanded allegiance. Paul said, but you don't belong to this world. Your allegiance is to Jesus Christ. Loyal, faithful. And I think this word, and N.T. Wright talks about this, encapsulates all these three meanings. And so when he uses them, it means all three. To be faithful is to exercise faith. To be faithful is to know the content of what you believe. To be faithful is to be loyal, to be totally committed. And that means in my life, the battle will be not just whether or not I believe in the idea of being holy, but whether or not I will live into that despite the pressures of the age I'm living in. I will live for him completely. It means to be completely committed to God and completely loyal to who Jesus is. When Paul writes, I love these little things because no one teaches on them, I don't think. And I love them because the Bible sort of throws these names in and we don't know who they are. Most of us don't even think about it and chase it down. And I'm just imagining what it was like for them to have their name mentioned in these books. I mean, and he mentions this man named Epaphras. He says, he describes him in this way in Colossians chapter 1. And he says in verse 7, you've learned it from Epaphras, a dear fellow servant, who was a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf. Here's Epaphras, right? Epaphras is probably from Colossae. And years before, there was a mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Ephesus. Paul arrives there in 52 AD. He writes this letter. It's now 62 AD. And now it's been 10 years, right? He mentions Epaphras. Epaphras had come from Colossae to hear Paul preach more than likely. And there was powerfully impacted. And he became a church planter. And Epaphras went back and founded the church in Colossae. He founded the church in Hierapolis. He founded the church in Laodicea. And Acts talks about how the gospel was spread throughout all of Asia. as God poured out his Spirit, lives were powerfully impacted. And this man, Epaphras, he was a man of faith. He was a man who knew what he believed, and he was a man who was committed. He lived it out. He lived what he believed. And then, at the end of the book, the same thing said about someone you probably never heard about. His name is Tychicus. Colossians 4:7. Tychicus will tell you the news about me. He is our dear brother, a faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord. And you think, who is this guy? Guess who he is? He's the man who carries the letter to Colossae. He not only carries the letter, he carries the letter of Ephesians to the Ephesians. He carries the letter of Philemon to Colossae as well. And not only does he carry the letter, he reads the letter. He's the one reading this to the church at Colossae. Can you imagine? He's reading and his name comes up. Tychicus, that's me. Will tell you all about me. Why? Because he's not only reading the letter, he's teaching the letter. He's explaining it to them because he was a faithful man, a man of faith, who exercised faith, a man who knew what he believed, and a man who was loyal. You come to see a principle of what God's doing in this letter. God advances his work on earth through faithfulness. Faithfulness. People whose hearts belong to God, who want to know him, they're not just coming to church to come to church because you're supposed to go to church or somebody made me go to church. They're coming because they want to know Jesus. They want to draw close to him. Their lives belong to him. And they serve and they give and they help because they know the kingdom is extended on faithfulness. People who faithfully give, people who faithfully share their faith, people who faithfully pray. That's how it happens. Faithfulness. You look at this and you realize it's the issue. It's the issue of religion. I use that word purposely. The problem of religion is it becomes just an external thing. It becomes just something that can become so superficial. But lives are not really in it. They're not really connected. Jesus talks about it. Of course, in the prophet Isaiah, he's challenging the spiritual leadership, and he's really pushing on them. He's really letting them have it. Especially in the Gospel of Matthew, he's really going at them. And finally, he says to them, he quotes from Isaiah, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." That's just the issue, right? You can be in a building where Jesus Christ is healing people, and people can sit there and never, never be moved by it. They can never experience him. They can be in a room where one person's being transformed and somebody else willfully disengages. You can be in a place where the atmosphere of God is moving so strong where other lives are disconnected. You know why? Because the hearts are not engaged. And each person gets to choose how they'll live their life, what their life will look like, who will define them, whether they want this world or whether they want God's will and purposes for their life. And the battle is for the vision for your life, whether or not your heart will honor him, not just your lips, but your life will be fully his. They worship me in vain. Teachings are just rules taught by people. Later, Jesus tells a story about the parable of talents, you know. He's in Jerusalem then. He begins to challenge the leaders. And he says, God's gifted people different ways. And that's the image, how it's applied. Some are, you know, really gifted. Some are a little less gifted, but they're still gifted. Some are even less gifted, but you know, God's given them all gifts according to their abilities. And we'll see how they use them, what they use them for. Whether for this world or for God. And one man takes what little he has and just misunderstands who God is. That's how the parable's applied, really. God, you may be the ruler here, the one who's in charge. And misunderstands him as a harsh and mean-spirited leader, which is all wrong. God loves him. God loves him. And because of his misunderstanding of who God is, he's lived his life the wrong way. And the story, though, is clear. It's the kingdom extends and expanded on faithfulness. So when it comes to your vision, you want to always say this in every season. I say this to the young and the old. Lord, my life is yours completely. But Lord, I want everything, who I am and how you've made me. The gifts you've given me, the abilities you've given me to be faithfully used for you. I'll give it all to you. All to you. Which brings us to the final point, which is fruitful. The picture, right? It's holy, faithful, fruitful. And that's the picture here. And so he it's so tricky. You know, we read these things, and he says in the very first verse, right? He says, grace, he says, Paul, an apostle by the will of God, right? And he says, to the holy people, faithful people. Then he adds this phrase, grace and peace, and we blow right past it. We just think there's nothing to it. But it's a little wordplay. He's taken a typical Greco-Roman letter or greeting, and he's changed it. And I think it's significant. He doesn't always letters. He likes doing this throughout his correspondence. He changes things that are commonly known in the Roman world, and he Christianizes them. He changes what they say. He changes the content of them. And so he begins the letter, and he says, in the Greek, he'd be kyrene. To you, kyrene, he says to you. That's what it should say. Instead, he says, charis. Kyrene, charis. Play on words. They're expecting greetings. He says, grace. He takes this concept because they know about grace. God's empowering grace. Takes the word peace. He's talking to a Greek audience and Roman and a Jewish audience who's in this church, and more Gentiles than Jews, but they're in this church. And he uses the word shalom, peace. They expect shalom, and he uses kyrene, Christianizes the kairos, to charis, to grace, and he uses shalom, peace, or really irene in the Greek. He uses this, and he says, you know, grace and peace to you. And the point is, he's saying, God's presence is coming upon you to give you empowering for what you need. Grace to you because God gives grace, not just unmerited favor, but that grace is full of power, and that grace is full of peace or wholeness. And that is what heaven visits upon your life today. This gospel, this book is so full of rich meanings. He tells them about what it's like to be a people of grace, this atmosphere that we live in, this atmosphere of grace. And then he spoke of the seed. He spoke about what God's planted in their heart and how it seeds to make a difference. And he uses this word. He says in verse 6, all over the world, this gospel is bearing fruit and growing. We hear the word gospel. If I were to say, what's gospel? What does it mean? And you would, maybe certain things would come to your mind. What that word means and what's employed. I want to give you some things you probably don't know about this word that are historically defined, and it's really important to understand it. I had a colleague when I was teaching at SMU at Perkins for 10 years who was from England, Andrew Walker. In fact, Andrew is the man who Heidi Baker studied under him in London to get her PhD. But Andrew taught there at the same time I did, and he taught a class on what is the gospel. It's so fun. Give people to think about what is the gospel. Here's some things you may not know. More than likely, Paul's the first one to use the word gospel in the New Testament. Now, I know you're thinking, well, aren't the gospels are first? Probably they're written after Paul's letters. In fact, Mark uses the word gospel in the very beginning of his gospel. He may have gotten the word from Paul. The second thing is, this word gospel has a twofold meaning. It has a Jewish background and a Roman background. In its Jewish background, it comes from the prophet Isaiah, where the prophet says, talking to people in exile, there is coming, in exile in Babylon, there is coming a day when God is going to bring a new exodus. It'll be glad tidings of great joy. It will be glad tidings. Blessed is the one who brings the glad tidings. A new exodus is coming in the earth. And Isaiah talked about it. A new exodus. The word gospel means new exodus. But in the Roman world, one of the earliest references is regarding Caesar Augustus, who began the Roman Empire, Octavian. In fact, the word gospel was used to describe his birthday. It marked a new season in the Roman world. A new season has begun in the earth because of Caesar Augustus. And Paul pulls together the Jewish meaning, the Roman meaning, and he's declaring, you are a part of a new exodus. You've been set free from your past, from this world, and a new season has come for the entire planet. A new season of the earth. This gospel, this good news. And all over the world, this word is bearing fruit. Jesus said his word, his kingdom is like a seed. It's so powerful. It can produce 100-fold. If people's lives will be nurtured by it and they'll embrace it and they'll live in it, their life can produce 100-fold fruit because of the power of Jesus' word, that good news, that gospel. A new season has come. A new season of victory, a new season. And Paul begins to pray into it. And we have now, and I'm just going to quickly go to it. He has this long prayer, and it's a great prayer. I want to encourage all to pray this prayer over the next 7 weeks, to pray this prayer that begins in verse 9. You just make note of it and pray it frequently. And if you want to pray it every day, pray it over yourself, pray it over this church. Just begin to declare it. Begin to declare it. Because you begin to pray out of a spirit of grace and a spirit of peace. He says, I've not stopped praying for this. And now we see the content of his prayers, that you would know God's will. Not just know it, like just know it, but that you would go, I want God's will for my life above everything else in this world. I want his will all the days of my life. My life belongs to no one else but Jesus. And I'm praying, he says, that something inside of you will rise up that says, I want him more than I want this world. I want what he offers, not what this world offers. That something, the Holy Spirit inside of you will wake up and you'll shake off this world and step into the destiny of God. And he begins to declare that, pray over their lives. I've not stopped praying it, he says. And I'm praying that you may want to live a life that pleases God. That your life in everyday decisions, your choices you make in your life, say, my desire is to please him in how I live, in the choices I make, and how I live my everyday life. And Paul will break down household behavior, how we live in our homes, how we live in the world, to please him. That our lives will bear fruit and everything, that God would use us to be effective. And that you'd be strengthened with all power in the inner being, because you can't do it on your own. That you'd be able to step into the atmosphere of God's presence and begin to draw upon the power of heaven to be his people. Look, God wants us to live for him. We need to own the vision he has for our lives. So today I want to encourage you to embrace that vision. Holy, faithful, and fruitful. You know, I'm praying that in this dark season on earth, that God's people would stand out because of the quality of our lives and the quality of our ability to love, to carry his presence. But religious people won't be able to do that because that's just too external. It has to come from here. There has to be an awakening of the heart for the church to step into its destiny. Every now and then I get thinking, and it's a dream, I know it is. I get thinking, here we are in Washington Crossing. I've heard me say this before. From this place, America was changed. When the British surrendered, they said Washington Crossing was the turning point of the American Revolution. Oh, maybe we're praying over the world. I don't say it's in the arrogance. I say it in deep humility. I dream that God would change our nation and that God would begin here. He'd do it in us. It's not an easy road. You take up your cross and deny yourself and follow him. That's what Jesus said. That's the word. It's not, hey, it's going to be fun. We're going to have pizza. It's going to be great. It's going to be, nah, it's going to be painful. It's going to hurt. People are going to hate you. But it's worth it all. So we're going to close in worship. You know, we can't move around here because we're in this space, but maybe you want to just surrender your life to him. I saw we did last night. We sort of stood on the fire line. Maybe you want to stand up here. If you want to come up, you can. Just spread out, you know, keep apart. And you just want to surrender your life to him in this season. Say, Lord, I surrender everything in my life to you. Everything, everything. Who I am, my dreams, my decisions, my purposes, my gifts, everything, all yours, God. I say it in this season. Now I say it. I won't settle for anything less but your will for my life. That's worship.
I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't know me. More than anything that you can do, I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started, open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started, open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this whole. Never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings.
What you've done in your life, Jesus loves you. And that gospel, that good news, said that God's grace abounds to us in our greatest need, that where sin abounded, grace abounded all the more. Maybe you're going through a situation, you made some bad decisions, and all you do is beat yourself up. You condemn yourself for what you've done. You feel the judgment of what you've done. Well, that's why Jesus died. Jesus took that judgment. He took that judgment upon his life, so you could have new life. Grace abounds to you. And God wants to show you can have a new beginning. Your life can start over. That what you've done may have been bad and really upset your life and others, but God can change you. The power of God can change your life. And he wants your life to be a witness of the world of how good he is. So he calls you out of your pain. He calls you out of your brokenness. He calls you into the good news. Today is a day of celebration for you. It's when his gospel, his word, breaks forth into your life. So I want to encourage you today to take hold of that word and say, yes, God, this world says I'm no good, but I believe that you can make me good. I believe, Jesus, you died for me. Your word is for me. I believe that heaven loves me. I believe that you can change my life. Today in your life, you may not believe that, but you want to take hold of what God believes about you. Take hold of what God says about you. Today can be your new beginning. So begin to pray with me. Lord, today I give my life to you. I step out of my own judgment. I step out of the judgment of this world. And Lord, I receive your good news for me. I give my life to you. I open my heart to you. I open up my life to all that heaven has for me. I want your will for my life, and I want you to change me. I want you to transform me. I want the power of heaven to impact my life so that my life can show how great and how wonderful you are. I give my life to you, Jesus. I receive your forgiveness. I declare today is my day of new beginning. And I pray this all in Jesus' name. God bless you all. I want to thank you for being here today and thank you for watching. And may the God of peace himself give you peace in any and every situation. The Lord be with you all. God's blessing.